As we said, this is a relatively brief series, only the seventh meeting. Last time they met was 2001. Tennessee won in South Bend. At least one team has been ranked in all seven of the meetings. They will get together again next year in South Bend. Tennessee won the toss. They have deferred the option for the second half, which means Notre Dame will receive and James Wilhoit will do the kickoff chores. Matt Beatman to return, and Chase Anastasio is the other. Shelton, blazing speed, 4.23 measured when he was a high schooler. That's in a 40-yard dash.
Another little interesting note about this game, Big Ten officials will be calling the game here in Knoxville.
And the referee is Jim Lapatina. Wilhoit's kick, we're underway. Well, Shelton finally grabs it, and he is knocked backward. Jabari Davis, number 34. Backup fullback.
Well, confusion, who should take the ball? They didn't get off to a good start, and then Jabari Davis with the planting tackle to start this football game.
Brady Quinn is the quarterback, the sophomore from Dublin, Ohio. Just under 2,000 yards for the season, 10 touchdowns, 7 interceptions.
He told us yesterday the key for him today is communicating, making sure everybody's on the same page in this hostile environment.
He'll throw on first down, looks left all the way, fires it out, it's complete. And that's good to Raymond McKnight, and that is also good for a first down after a gain of 16 yards. And now the starting lineups presented by Cialis. In the offensive line, Ryan Harris, Bob Morton, John Sullivan, Dan Stevens, and Mark Lavoie. In the backfield, it's Grant, Rashawn Powers, Neal, wideouts Shelton and McKnight, the tight end Anthony Fasano.
Good group of wide receivers and an excellent group of tight ends, and you'll see Brady Quinn spread the ball all over the place.
Here's a play fake. He still got it. Comes right. Good downfield coverage. He is pursued and knocked out of bounds at the 32-yard line by Paris Harrelson, number 98. Defensively for Tennessee. Take a look at the front four. Harrelson, who just made the tackle, is joined by Harold Mahalona, who's having a wonderful season, and Carlton Neal. Omar Gaither, Jason Mitchell, Kevin Burnett are the linebackers. The secondary, Rashawn Fellows, Jason Allen, Jonathan Hefney. I hesitate. Robert Boulware gets the start at strong safety, his first, and that has been a problem area for Tennessee. On second down, here comes the blitz. Run blitz, right side, Ryan Grant to the 34. Well, we mentioned that Notre Dame lost a heartbreaker at home to Boston College 2 weeks ago. They had an off week to regroup, and since 1984, the Irish 23-2 after an off week.
That's a good number. 8 wins, you see, against ranked teams. They've actually won their last 14 in a row following a bye week, but I'm not sure many of those games came against a team like Tennessee in a place like Neyland Stadium. So a huge challenge for Brady Quinn and the Irish here today.
3rd and 4. Raymond McKnight and Matt Shelton to the wideouts. Fasano, the tight end, is tight right. This is McKnight in motion. Tennessee rushes 4. Quinn behind his intended receiver, McKnight. It'll be 4th down.
The only positive on that drive for Notre Dame, they were able to protect Brady Quinn on a couple passing attempts. Tennessee rushed 4, and really the strength of this defense has been their front 4. And they weren't able to get to Quinn that time, but he wasn't able to make the connection.
DJ Fitzpatrick on to punt. That 42.8 average represents an improvement of 6 yards over a year ago.
This is an area I think Notre Dame has to really be solid in. Kick the ball well and covering kicks. They've got to try to keep field position in their advantage today.
Casey Dunn snaps it back. This is low and returnable. Derek Tinsley at the 19-yard line. Out of one tackle into another. He is dropped at the 29-yard line by Maurice Stovall, number 21, a wide receiver on this Irish team. So the Volunteers hold. They yield one first down, but they've got the ball back, and they've got good field position at their own 29. 6 weeks. Cedric Houston had 190 yards last week. He's in the backfield, and here's Ainge quickly firing out to the right side. That's caught by Jason Swain, number one. And Ainge on the mark with his first pass. Now let's meet the offensive line for Tennessee. Michael Munoz, roster. Chuck Prue, six-year senior, will develop the story throughout the afternoon. This is his first start ever. Houston, Anderson in the backfield, Hannon and Brown, and McClure is the tight end. Second down. And the handoff goes to Cedric Houston, and there's Justin Tuck, number 44. Irish defense particularly tough against the run, where they yield an average of just 100 yards per game. And up front, it's Tuck, Greg Pauly, Derek Landry, and Kyle Budenzak. The linebackers in the middle, it's Mike Goolsby, flanked by Hoyt and Derek Curry. And in the secondary, Dwight Ellick, Quentin Burrell, Tom Zibikowski, and Jackson. Third and four. Ainge will throw. Fires it deep. He's got Swain again. And across the 50, down to the 44-yard line. 21-yard gain. I will say this, he didn't look him off.
No, he didn't. But he did a nice job of sidestepping the pressure and making the throw under duress. Jason Swain, a physical receiver, 210 pounds. Strong going across the middle, and it's hard to rip that ball out. You can see they're trying to rip the ball out, but Swain probably the strongest of the Tennessee wide receivers. Good third down conversion for the Vols.
Gain of 21, a first down at the 44. Backs in the eye now. And Anderson leads Cedric Houston through a gain of a couple.
I think the real challenge for Notre Dame today is going to be when Tennessee goes to their spread type formations. When they stay in a normal one tight end, two backs, that's when Notre Dame plays their best. But when you spread them out by formation and make them play in space, then maybe the speed difference takes over. That'll be the biggest challenge, I think, today for Notre Dame on defense.
Here's the audible as Eric Ainge looks over at Randy Sanders, the offensive coordinator. There's Randy Sanders, one-time quarterback at Tennessee in the mid-80s. Handoff, big hole. Here goes Houston. Houston, we have a problem. He got tripped up as he was headed for six. Quentin Burrell saved the touchdown by getting in the way. 25-yard gain.
Well, this is a little trick play. Now watch the fullback. They're going to trap the nose guard. They're going to let the nose guard come across the field, and the fullback is going to knock him right on his backside. That's a perfect play call. Trevor Laws was in there at the nose guard position, and the fullback, Corey Anderson, clocked him.
Gain of 25, first down. C.J. Faiton starts in motion. Here's the handoff to Houston again, this time met behind the line and driven down. This was Derek Curry, number 49, with the tackle.
I'm going to go back to that last play and say, how can a fullback knock down a defensive tackle? Well, this fullback, Corey Anderson, is 270 pounds. He's not your typical fullback. He's 6'3", 270 pounds. That was a special play that they put in for this Notre Dame defense.
Cedric Houston last week, 190 yards. You saw that in the previous four games. His accumulated total was 117. He had given away in large part to Gerald Riggs. And then Riggs with a hip pointer last week. Houston filled the void big time.
Offside. Defense. Offside. Number 77. 5 yard penalty from the previous spot.
Jim Lapatina.
Still second down.
Looks like Greg Pauly.
The interesting thing about Cedric Houston is Randy Sanders, the offensive coordinator, told us that he's really responded well to challenges this year. And every time, you know, he's been faced with a little adversity or looked like something was going to pass him up, he's responded. That's what he did last week. And he hoped that he felt challenged again this week here against Notre Dame.
And here's the change again with Eric Ainge. He'll come left side. And a good job defensively by Derek Landry, number 66, as he gets to Houston at about the point of contact. It's going to bring up a third down and long.
Notre Dame's defensive coordinator Kent Bear said he thought Landry's been playing as well as anybody they've had up front. He's a guy that came in with a lot of hype out of Concord, California, De La Salle High School, and now playing his best football in his junior season. Was a high school teammate of Kevin Simon, who was the starting middle linebacker for Tennessee before he injured his knee in the Florida game.
That's Landry wearing number 66. Kevin Simon out for the year. Here's Ainge back. And he's only been sacked twice this year. And he gets loose, and it's in the end zone. Tipped and incomplete. Intended for Faton. Preston Jackson was there.
And credit to pressure by the Notre Dame front. They were able to force Eric Ainge into some movement. He wasn't able to throw that ball on rhythm, and when he did throw it, he wasn't able to get quite enough on it to get the touchdown. Good rush by the Notre Dame front.
James Wilhoit, the sophomore, was a freshman All-American a year ago. He has had a kind of lackluster season. 5 of 10 for the year. This one from 30 yards out, and that is not to dismiss the big one he hit, which was a 50-yard game winner against Florida. This one is good, but there's a flag down.
The flag was down and the kicker was down, and it may end up being a penalty against Notre Dame, which could give Tennessee the football back. Could be a very costly penalty against the Irish. The question is it roughing the kicker or running into the kicker?
Running into the kicker on a defense, number 24, the penalty here to decline, field goal is good.
Well, running into the kicker as opposed to roughing the kicker.
Roughing would have given them a first down, and they would have brought their offense back. 5-yard penalty, don't take points off the scoreboard. 3-0 Tennessee.
Shelton and Anastasio will be the deep men.
Last time, a little miscommunication on who should field the kick, and they started with poor field position.
This one high, returnable. Anastasio takes it a yard deep, hesitates, and decides to bring it out, and again pays a price.
They better figure out what the heck they want to do, because that is no way to start against this defense. Now they're saying that he touched his knee down in the end zone. I think they're going to put the ball in the 20. But...
well, that's a break for the Irish.
You can see Shelton's telling him to stay in there. And I don't know what they're... He hesitated, but he never put his knee down. But nonetheless, they're giving him the ball on the 20-yard line.
Explain that to me, boss.
I can't do it. The guy in the white hat down there needs to explain it, not me.
There was no knee touchdown. If this was a Big Ten game, we'd be in replay.
Yeah.
That was very interesting, the call by the official. There's Ryan Grant for a modest gain, and we go back to New York, and a modest person. Here's Tim Brando.
Yeah, right. Thank you, Vern. Sovell Newton trying to do for Lou Holtz what hasn't been done in 3 years, and that's getting the 6th win. He finds Troy Williamson. You got to wrap him up. That gives South Carolina the lead. And then Matt Jones, for some reason, throws into triple coverage. Coach Simpson, the pick, the Gamecocks with a much-needed 6th bowl-eligible win. Back to you.
Tim, it's not often we get you, but I think we got you.
Good comeback for the Gamecocks after that tough loss to Tennessee last week.
Marcus Wilson in, and with Carlisle Holiday gets it. Former quarterback.
Go back a few plays. It was a good defensive stop by Notre Dame to force the field goal, but on the third down play, the pressure from Victor Abiyamiri forced Eric Ainge to throw the ball late to the end zone, and then Ndikwe with a nice tip away, and this ball was almost intercepted by Carlos Campbell.
What's Ndikwe's first name?
Can I just say Ndikwe?
I want to see if you can qualify.
That's
very good. Yeah. You now qualify to do figure skating with me.
Okay.
And Tracy Wolfson.
Yeah. I'll pass.
Ice Wars is coming up. 3rd and 3, Ryan Grant. Here's Quinn, flag down before the snap.
And this is going to be a 5-yarder on Notre Dame, dead ball foul. And tough, they would have had the conversion there on 3rd and short. Now it'll be 3rd in a longer situation.
Prior to the snap, false start. Offense, the center, double snap. 5-yard penalty, go 3rd down.
Against John Sullivan, number 78. Well, in their wins, you can see they have run the ball very well.
Yeah.
Conversely.
Well, and that's a big thing because I think Brady Quinn is an emerging talent at quarterback, but if he has to throw the ball 30, 35, 40 times, that doesn't give them the best chance to win. They've got to have some balance in their offense. They don't have to run for a ton of yards, but they have to be efficient.
Here's Quinn under pressure. Lobs it out. It's caught by Maurice Stovall, the big wide receiver, and he maneuvers himself into position for a first down.
He looked like a tight end in there, didn't he? He's 6'5", 227 pounds out of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, a very physical guy. I mean, you see that when he blocks in the running game, but you saw it right there in the middle of the field, bouncing off the linebackers. Watch as this play unfolds. You're going to see Stovall end up here in the middle of the field and appear late for Brady Quinn. There he is, and as he catches it, he just uses his strength and bounces off of a couple tackles to get the first down.
And a rare missed tackle by Kevin Burnett that allowed him the yardage necessary. Marcus Wilson is in now.
Oh boy. They got it set.
Marcus Wilson still free. Across the 50 to the 48-yard line, Jason Allen with the tackle. But that is a gain of 18 to complement the previous gain of 12.
Nice little play, the quick screen, and anything to try to keep this defense off balance. Kevin Burnett, one of the leaders, second play in a row, not able to wrap up and make the tackle. Got caught with a bad angle, chasing down Marcus Wilson on that time, and another productive play for the Notre Dame offense.
Now Darius Walker, the true freshman out of Lawrenceville, Georgia, the hero, one of the heroes in the win over Michigan in game two this year is in. He gets the toss, comes right. Cuts it back inside, and another big game all the way down to Jason Allen's tackle at the 16-yard line.
You know, I didn't say anything about this when we first came on the air, but as I always do, I was down on the field before the game, and there was something that I sensed during warm-ups that there was more focus on the Notre Dame side than there was on the Tennessee side. It was a little bit more of a, you know, having fun and slapping hands and maybe not as serious in the pregame for Tennessee as it was for Notre Dame. This is an important statement type game for both of these teams, and I think Notre Dame came into it maybe with a little bit more focus.
How about the last three plays? 12 yards, 18 yards, 32 yards. And that 12 play came on a 3rd and 9. Here's Darius Walker inside the 10 down to the 8-yard line. Robert Boulware makes the tackle, number 22.
And again, this is positive running. I mean, they only average 125 yards a game. They don't need to run for 250 against Tennessee, but they've got to run enough to keep this fast and aggressive Tennessee defense honest and to keep them off balance. And we've seen some good runs. We've seen some screens. We've seen some quick throws from Brady Quinn. They've got a nice little mixture going on. Again, they had a bye week. They had 2 weeks to prepare for this game. And they look fresh, and they look like they've got a nice plan today.
And in contrast, this is Tennessee's 8th game in as many weeks. Play fake. Quinn rolls out to his right, drills it in the end zone. It's caught for a touchdown. Anthony Fasano bobbled it, caught it. 8 yards, touchdown, Notre Dame leads.
This play really made possible because of the good play fake by Brady Quinn. And Paris Harrelson, the defensive end, bit on the play fake, and that allowed Brady Quinn to get out. Watch Harrelson bite on the fake, and that allows Quinn to get outside free and find his tight end, Fasano, crossing into the end zone.
DJ Fitzpatrick is the punter and the place kicker for the Irish. It's up and good. Well, it began with a hesitation on bringing the ball out of the end zone. A bit of help from the official spotting the ball at the 20. It culminates in a touchdown for Tyrone Willingham. Bobby Rinkus will kick off, number 96. As the Irish go 80 yards in 7 plays, they gouged out yardage. The biggest play was a 32-yard run by Darius Walker. And here is the kick from Rinkus. And this is Corey Larkins to return it at the 5. Now at the 10. And he gets all the way to the 11. Rob Woods. Back to the touchdown.
Yeah, let's go back, and I want to show you a couple things. Jason Allen is the free safety. He's having a great year right now for Tennessee, but watch as the tight end crosses on the bootleg. Jason Allen is going to get himself out of position a little bit. He's going to get caught up in the play fake. He's going to get a little too wide, and as he tries to react back, he's just a hair late getting there. Now, you mentioned, Vern, the secondary, and in particular the safety position, has been an area of weakness and concern for this team this year. Now, Jason Allen has had a great year, but the guys around him in the other safety position has been a little bit of a mystery.
Here's Ainge, right side, too far. It was intended for Chris Hanna, number 13, and Eric Ainge out there. Let's go back to the studio for this Pontiac game-changing performance. Once again, here's Tim.
And it could be season-changing in the Big East. Damian Rhodes from 2 yards out in overtime, number two, to get the Cuse the lead. Then on fourth and one, Pittsburgh's Raymond Kirkley doesn't get it. West Virginia in a full game and a half up in the Big East, Vern.
Ah, thank you, Tim. Here's Houston with the handoff. And that's going to bring up a third down.
The longer that Tennessee doesn't play aggressive or focused in this game, the longer they let Notre Dame hang around here, the harder it's going to be to put this team away. This is not a team that is not used to playing in big games. I mean, that's part of the identity of Notre Dame football. Even though they're 5-3, I mean, this is a team that is accustomed to playing big games. And don't forget, they beat a pretty good Michigan football team early in the year.
Here's Ainge. Brett Smith has it, number 9. Out to the 21-yard line. That will be close for a first down. Brett Smith, who has an amazing touchdown-to-touch ratio this year. Had a 44-yard onside return, onside kick return for a TD last week.
Yeah, and I think that's a good idea by offensive coordinator Randy Sanders, try to get him the football. I mean, anytime you got a guy who has got 11 catches and 5 of them are for touchdowns, you may want to find a way to get the ball in his hands. Good things happen when he touches it.
That was a first down, and here's Ainge back to throw. Flips it out left side. He was picked fullback Corey Anderson, and I mean big. Yeah. 270, as Todd said. Dwight Ellick makes the tackle.
And for a guy that big, he has very soft hands. And we saw him block and block on the nose guard, but he really does have soft hands. That's his 8th catch of the season. Big guy lumbering out there with soft hands.
Philip Fulmer, 13th year as a head coach at his alma mater. First, second down. Ainge under Chuck Prue, making his first start of his career today. Left side. Stopped by Robert Meacham, number 3. He gives us a chance to spend a few moments with the third member of our team. Here's Tracy Wolfson.
Thanks, Vern. Each week, Notre Dame carries out a medal chain. It is here today, and it symbolizes the unity of this Irish defense. Each player is given a link each week, and on Fridays, they put those links together and reinforce the point that you are only as strong as your weakest link. We spoke to defensive end Justin Tuck yesterday. He told us the chain is even more important today because they need to reunite and rebound after that tough loss to Boston College 2 weeks ago.
Now, this was the idea of Derek Curry, and it was around his neck when they came out. And here's Ainge high and wide with the pass, and that's going to bring up another second down and long.
I thought it was interesting when we talked to both Eric Ainge, the freshman quarterback, and Randy Sanders, the offensive coordinator. They both said, you know, this defense, when we watch them on film, they just look smart. You know, they're well coached and they look smart. They're 9 of the 11 starters are seniors. They've played a lot of football. You've got a couple starters with 30 plus starts in their career, and they don't get themselves out of position too much. They may not be as athletic as some of the defenses Tennessee faces, but a very smart, rugged defense.
Draw play. Houston out to the 40-yard line, and that's going to bring up a third down. And it gives us a chance once again to go back to New York. Here's Tim.
Vernon Todd, apparently no Baylor hangover evident in College Station. Watch Reggie McNeil. Little pump fake. Little ad-lib job. Terrence Murphy on the receiving end. Last year, OU beat A&M 77-0. Today, what about that wrecking crew defense?
Aha.
Well, Oklahoma had some problems with the passing game of Oklahoma State last week, and Reggie McNeil, an outstanding quarterback down there in College Station.
3rd and 4. Here's the snap from Prue. Ainge has it, and that's incomplete. It'll bring up 4th down. Ainge a little high and a little tall.
Well, last week, Michael Munoz did not play in the South Carolina game because of a concussion. This is going to be a great matchup. All-American versus another All-American. He got a little help in there from Rob Smith, but Michael Munoz used to working against outstanding pass rushers, and he's going to have a nice challenge today from Justin Tuck.
Now, here's Dustin Colquitt, who was an All-American a year ago, and by his own admission, is having an off-season, averaging just under 42 yards per punt. And that one, line drive, Carlisle Holiday at the 19-yard line. Gets it back out near the 28-yard line.
He just doesn't look the same, you know? I mean, kicking is so much confidence, and it's mental, and he just doesn't seem to be kicking it nearly as confidently as we saw him kick the ball last season.
Years ago, yeah, her line was, "The press is ready for you now." She gets a residual every year from Screen Actors Guild.
That's good.
Last year it was 89 cents. There's a pass complete to Maurice Stovall, number 21.
You know, and I go back to the idea from the warm-ups that this does not look like a focused Tennessee team that has won a lot of tough ball games in this 8-game stretch. Stovall crossing the field, but the biggest problem, no pass rush on Brady Quinn. They went bootleg again, and no pressure whatsoever. He had time to wait for Stovall to come all the way across the field to make the catch.
Stovall still down, and the medical staff has made the long trot from near side to the far side. And Todd mentioned he is a big one, 6'5". And this has become a game of big plays for Notre Dame.
Stovall getting up a little gingerly, but here he is right here on the bottom, and he's going to come all the way across the field, and watch how much time Brady Quinn's going to have back here to find him crossing the field. Four-man rush by Tennessee, nobody near, no orange jerseys near Quinn, and Stovall catches it all the way on the other side of the field for a big game.
And here's a gaudy stat for you if you're collecting gaudy stats. Notre Dame is averaging 11.3 yards per play. That would seem to indicate a certain defensive lack of focus.
Yeah. Well, again, it's got to get back to their front. I mean, the key to the Tennessee defense has been the emergence of their front four and their ability to pressure the quarterback. But they have not been able to do that so far today against Brady Quinn.
This is Josh Schmidt leading the way for Ryan Grant. Kevin Burnett. Now, Tyrone Willingham, after 7 years as the head coach at Stanford, came in to replace Bob Davey in 2002. The class of 2002, Jed Tedford, of course, at Cal, 21-12. Willingham with a 20-13 record. Ron Zook just got fired a week and a half ago. Chan Gailey, Paul Johnson of the Naval Academy. In my view, Tyrone Willingham's not in any kind of trouble, but you hear rumblings from the Midwest.
Well, you know, their fan base has got a lot of high expectations. I think that the guy's doing a pretty good job, and they need to let him continue to build, give him an adequate chance.
That one tipped away by Jonathan Hefty, number 33. It was intended for Matt Shelton. Hefty, true freshman.
He had his first career interception last week in his home state of South Carolina. Almost came up with number two there, cutting underneath the intended receiver, Shelton. Got to believe that Matt Shelton hopes to have a good game today. He's one of the four Tennessee natives on this Notre Dame team out of Collierville, Tennessee.
Raymond McKnight breaks wide to the left. It's third down and four. McKnight, Jeff Samardzija are the wideouts. Samardzija's in the slot. Here's Quinn back. Underneath for Samardzija, it's incomplete. He should have had it.
Now, he should have had it, but it was thrown fairly hard for such a short pass by Brady Quinn. Nice idea on the crossing route with Samardzija and the tight end, but this one was pretty hot and high coming to Samardzija, and he wasn't able to corral it for the first down. Tyrone Willingham now choosing to play field position, hoping that DJ Fitzpatrick can pin Tennessee down.
Inside the final minute, quarter number one, Derek Tinsley has pitched his camp at the 10-yard line. And here is DJ Fitzpatrick. Angles it toward the right, and a fair catch taken by Derek Tinsley in between the 11 and 12-yard lines. 25-yard punt. Let's go down to Tracy Wolfson for this SEC moment presented by Sonic.
Vern, the Vols trip to South Bend in 1991 is a legendary game. The Irish took a commanding 31-7 lead, but the lead wasn't safe. The comeback began when Tennessee's Darrell Hardy blocked a field goal late in the first half, and it was taken all the way in. Then Andy Kelly's screen pass to Aaron Hayden in the fourth quarter put Tennessee in front, 35-34. Notre Dame's potential game-winning field goal was tipped by Jeremy Lincoln as the Vols celebrated the miracle in South Bend, the largest comeback in school history.
And here is the handoff as Gerald Briggs gets it and is tackled by Brandon Hoyt. And we've got 25 seconds to go before the end of the quarter number one. Here's Brandon Hoyt, number 39. 7-3, Notre Dame, 8-yard touchdown pass. Brady Quinn to his tight end, Anthony Fasano. Second down and 7 here, motion in the line.
I don't think this one's going to be an offsides. I think this is going to be a down play for Tennessee and make it third down because there was movement, but there was no contact, and the defensive lineman got back. And what happened was Chuck Crew tried to snap the ball thinking they would draw him offsides, but you're allowed to get back. Watch, here's going to be the movement, but he's going to cross and get back without making contact. Chuck Crew snaps it, and all that is a wasted snap. And it brings up third down as we move to the second quarter.
So we played one. Leprechauns and others who follow the Fighting Irish have to be pleased so far. 7-3, Notre Dame will return to Neyland after this message and a word from your local son. Now at the 13-yard line, we open the second quarter, 3rd and 8. The ball actually officially on the 14. Out of the gun, here's Eric Ainge back under some pressure. He'll have to scramble. This is where they do miss Brent Schaefer. Yeah. Scrambling is not one of the strong points of Eric Ainge's arsenal. Vern Lundquist, Todd Blackledge, along with Tracy Wolfson with you from Neyland. Talked about it at the beginning. This is a game of consequence for both of these teams. A little lethargy in Tennessee's approach.
Yeah, and again, I kind of felt it and sensed it in the pregame warmups, and I thought that it was very important for Notre Dame to come in and play well early, to take the crowd out of it, to, you know, not let the speed of Tennessee overwhelm them early in the game. I think it's official now. Tennessee is in for a dogfight in this game because Notre Dame has come to play. They've got a good focus, and it looks like they've got a good plan on both sides of the ball so far.
Here is Colquitt to punt. Now, this is a beauty.
Yeah, good one there.
Oh, boy. Outstanding. And Carlisle Holiday gets away from it. It is down at the 23-yard line. A 59-yard punt for a puzzled Dustin Colquitt. He's been perplexed by the kind of season he's had. Colquitt, junior, part of the kicking Colquitt family of Tennessee. Younger brother Britton, his uncle Jimmy, his dad, all part of the tradition here. And that one was a good one. 2001, 38.8. Last year, 43.6, or rather 45.3, and you see the numbers for this year.
The one thing to remember, though, even though his average has not been as good, he's still near 40 yards net average, which is good for 12th in the country. So that's pretty good.
Here's the toss. Darius Walker comes left out of a tackle behind the line, gets across the 30 to the 32. Well, always a special time of the week each Saturday afternoon, the time for the Aflac trivia question of the week. In the history of the SEC, which SEC team has Notre Dame played the most? Now, there's a duck hook to this one, like one of my drives. So expand your horizons here. Think very broadly. It ain't Vanderbilt. Second and one. Brady Quinn out of Dublin, Ohio. Backs in the eye, hands it to the fullback. That's Rashawn Powers Neal, the senior from St. Paul, Minnesota. And he gets close for the first down. They might.
Quick job by Burnett coming from his linebacker position. Pulling the fullback back. Also, Turk McBride in there stopping the play right at the point of attack. Turk McBride really has emerged in this tackle rotation for Tennessee. He started out the year as a defensive end, and then ever since they moved him inside, not only has he played well, but it's really given them a three-man rotation now with Jesse Mahalona and Justin Harrell in there at the tackle position. You see just first down by Smidge.
Smidgen. Yeah.
Thank you.
Just part of my responsibility is to correct your grammar.
I appreciate that. Those, let's not get hung up on ceramics. That's what my dad would always say.
Oh, goodness.
Brady Quinn, 5 of 8 for 83 yards in the game. Hasn't thrown one in this possession. Might be a good time to see him throw it here on first down.
Five on the line. There's motion.
Now, see, Notre Dame tried to do the same thing that we saw Tennessee do. John Sullivan tried to snap the ball, thinking Tennessee was offsides, but there are no flags on the field. So I would tell both centers, let's get rid of that strategy. That's a waste of a play. You know, unless he hits you, don't snap it early. Brady Quinn used his snap count. There was movement, but you're allowed to get back as long as you don't make contact.
John Sullivan from Old Greenwich, Connecticut, on his maternal side. They say they can trace the family roots back to Voss, Norway, which is, of course, the birthplace of Knut Rockne, Voss, Norway. They've got a Rockne statue right by the lake. Ryan Grant is back in the lineup. Here's Brady Quinn under some pressure, fires it out, and it's caught by John Carlson. And let's go back and spend another moment with Tim Brando in New York.
All right, Vern, Jason White has 12 touchdown passes in his last 13 quarters of play here against that Wrecking Crew defense. He goes 31 yards to Travis Wilson. Meanwhile, Cal is trailing 20-14 to the Quack Attack in Berkeley. The BCS Darlings, number 4 Cal, struggling at home.
The BCS Darlings, Tim.
From Voss, Norway to Shreveport, Louisiana.
Yeah.
That's quite a hike.
We covered all in. Voss, Norway. Here's Quinn, right side. Raymond McKnight. Caught and dropped. It'll be fourth down.
Now there's where you see the speed of the Tennessee defense. And those kind of plays, you're hoping that you can catch them out of position and get up the field quick. Wide receiver screen, but this Tennessee defense, very athletic, very fast. Take a look as they try to throw it quick. Hope they catch Tennessee out of position, but they close quickly. Omar Gaither there, Jason Allen, Jason Mitchell. Good third down stop for the Vols.
And the third punt for DJ Fitzpatrick now. Early moments of the second quarter. Return is on. Derek Tinsley, this is a fine punt by Fitzpatrick. And that chases Tinsley back to the 12-yard line. And a chance to return. He runs partially into his own man. A tackle made by Joe Brockington. And a 52-yard punt, 12 on the return. 7-3, Notre Dame has the lead in front of a huge crowd at Neyland.
Whole experience. He said, while Notre Dame is a different team today than it has been, he reminded them that they are still Notre Dame and they demand respect.
Okay, Trace, thank you. That was in the fall of 1968. Philip was really animated when he was telling us the story yesterday. He said, do you guys remember Walt Podolsky? And some of us in this booth do. Mm-hmm. And I particularly remember him vividly. And he said he lined up against Podolsky. They had just changed him from linebacker to offensive guard. He said, I didn't even shave at the time. And I look across at this guy who became an All-American. So I had a long, long afternoon. Junior varsity and freshman game, one of five that they played that year. And here's a quick flip out to Brett Smith, and he did retain possession. He made the fumble, made the catch, and then lost the ball and gets up a little slowly.
A lot of cushion out there, respecting the speed of some of these Tennessee receivers. Dwight Ellick giving a lot of, or Mike Richardson rather, a lot of room out there to Brett Smith. A lot of zone defense by Notre Dame. Three-man rush on some third downs, four-man rush, but playing more zone than they are man-to-man right now. And so far, they've done a pretty good job because Eric Ainge now 6 of 10 throwing or 6 of 11 throwing the ball, but only one pass completion for over 10 yards. So they're trying to keep things in front.
Now they're having a conversation about where to spot the ball after the fumble. It has been spotted, and it is 2 chain links short of a first down, which is another definition of ceramics.
You like that, didn't
you? I like that. Yeah. You tell your dad, Ron, I like that a lot. And wish him the best.
Thank you.
He's doing well, I hear.
He is doing well. He's recovering from his back surgery very nicely.
3rd and inches. We'll know when we've affected the culture when they refer to it as 3rd and a smidgen. Eric Ainge, 18-year-old from Hillsboro, Oregon, just outside of Portland. He actually went to the Notre Dame-Michigan game with his teammate Kevin Simon during their off week back in September. And they hung around with Derek Landry, who played with Kevin Simon at Concord De La Salle. And they go right near Derek Landry on this play for the first down.
Take a look at Eric Ainge again. We'll only see one quarterback today unless Eric Ainge gets hurt. And you see nothing down here. No big plays down the field yet for Eric Ainge. Everything underneath. A lot of zone defense. And what that means for Eric Ainge is you just got to be patient. Remain patient. Take what the defense gives you. And wait for your opportunities to make a big play throwing the football. Don't get greedy and don't force anything.
Here's the handoff left side, quick opener, and a burst of speed puts Gerald Riggs out near the 44-yard line. And that's a fine run. Gain of 11, Mike Goolsby with a tackle. Well, Doug and Diane Ainge make the trip back for every home game. It is a long trip. It is a long trip. And you get a little tired. And Doug Ainge is going to shoot us when he finds out that we actually put that picture on television. There's Doug. Things are a little more lively now. Doug and Diane, and that's daughter Kimberly, who is also here today. Her first trip back. And the pass by Ainge on the right side. Caught by Jason Swain. Down to the 38-yard line.
And again, good job by Eric Ainge taking what the Notre Dame defense gives. If they want to play off the receivers, throw the quick hitch and let a strong receiver make a play one-on-one. Breaks the tackle of Preston Jackson and turns a 5-yard pass into about a 15-yard gain.
Swain has now caught 3 for 46 yards. Chuck Prue, number 67, the 6-year senior, over the ball. Jason Respert, who is the starter, out with an injury today. He left last week's game with a sprained ankle. Here's Ainge. He's now been sacked 3 times. That's Justin Vick. Avi Amari got there first, and then Vick completed it. Justin Vick.
Well, watch. Avi Amari is going to be the guy who gets there first. He comes from this end, and then Justin Tuck is going to finish him off. Avi Amari beats Munoz. He gets there first. And then Justin Tuck with his 5th sack of the season. And again, he is the guy that can make an impact, an explosive rusher off the edge.
And the senior from Kellington, Alabama, has become the all-time sack leader in the history of Notre Dame. He's broken the tie he held with Corey Minor at 22 and a half. He's in the books by himself. Ainge back. He'll run. And he picks up yardage to the 40. Mike Goolsby makes the tackle. There's Justin Tuck. Had 13 and a half sacks last year, very similar to the kind of season that David Pollack had in his sophomore year at Georgia. And he's now the career sack leader, most in Notre Dame history.
Quick, powerful. Does a nice job with stunts. And here we go, 3rd and long. 3-man rush by Tennessee. Probably drop 8 into zone. That's kind of been their strategy against Eric Ainge.
And that is what they do. Here's Ainge. Pressure. Flips it out. Caught. Gerald Riggs. They got to the 35. They needed to get to the 28.
And that's all that is 3 defensive linemen that are out fighting 5 offensive linemen for Tennessee. I mean, on a passing situation, you should not expect three to beat five. But that's exactly what's happening here. Three-man rush, and it's Kyle Budenzak that gets there first and forces the dump-off.
CBS Sports coverage of the Home Depot SEC continues after this word from your local station.
It'll get loud.
And as you can see from the graphic, they've yet to miss on a fourth down attempt. Here's Ainge, got a man wide open, and overthrows him. There's a flag down at the 39-yard line. But the receiver was wide open, Chris Annan.
Now they got holding against Tennessee, so it wouldn't have counted anyway. Is Ty Willingham going to decline and get the football back to his offense? But you're right, Hannon was open.
The offense, number 76, pounding
the
clock.
They got Aaron Sears,
first down.
The starter at right tackle. He's working on Budenzak, who is really giving some fits. And you can see Aaron Sears just tackled him at the end of the rush. This guy, Budenzak, a fifth-year guy, his 30th start, and he's causing some headaches for Philip Fulmer and the Tennessee offense right now.
At the Notre Dame 35-yard line, Marcus Wilson is the deep back. He gets the handoff and goes right. And doesn't get much. It is now time to answer our duck hook question, the
Aflac
trivia question of the week. We warned you, which SEC team has Notre Dame played the most? It's a trick question, admittedly. The answer is, if you like Karnak, Georgia Tech. They were members of the SEC from 1933 to 1963. That was a good one.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Second down and eight.
Do you think Pat Hayden would ever do the Aflac duck?
You know, it's a challenge the next time. He'll do the Pittsburgh game next week. I think here's the handoff to Marcus Wilson. We have now officially
issued the challenge.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, he's probably playing at the Los Angeles Country Club today and not watching this game, but he'll hear about it. Teams with a winning record against Notre Dame, Michigan, Florida State, NC State, 1-0, Nebraska, Tennessee's there, Georgia, 1-0. Those are the so-called major teams with winning records. Now, among the others, I love the fact that on this 135th anniversary of the start of college football, we get the Indianapolis Artillery into the broadcast. We come out with all guns blazing. Here's Quinn, deep right side, overthrows Rayma McKnight. This is too good a segue to pass up. Speaking of blazing guns, here's Tim.
I'm fully loaded, Vern. Anthony Davis of Wisconsin. Remember, the Badgers had last week off. It's all falling into place for them in the Big Ten. He takes it in. 17 rushes, 88 carries, 88 yards, two touchdowns. Took a little licking there, but Wisconsin up big over Minnesota, 28-0.
Minnesota. Gophers and Purdue have suffered major fall aparts.
Boy, you're not kidding.
7-3 in this one, second down and 10. Here's Quinn back, goes left. Samardzija, incomplete. Now we got a chance to spend a moment with Brady Quinn out of Dublin, Ohio yesterday. And he was talking about his first visit here. He came down for a football camp the summer before his senior year in 2002. Actually spent one day here in this stadium. He said it was a long, long day. His wide receiver suffered a broken leg, and they wound up at a local hospital emergency room for 5 hours. Got in the car and drove back. But he said, had he had time to think about it a little more, he might have made Tennessee one of his three ultimate teams in his list. He wanted to declare early, so he did for Notre Dame. Nice young man. Third and 10. Here's Quinn.
Got it.
There's another nice young man.
Jesse Mahalona. just when this defense needed a spark, this is the guy who has done it all season. His fifth sack of the season, here he is. Watch him working right here on Bob Morton, the right guard. It's actually two guys he beats. He splits the double team and dives right at Brady Quinn's legs, and that's the way he has played. He has really raised the level of play of the guys around him in the inside.
On fourth down after the Mahalona sack, here's DJ Fitzpatrick. This one not that effective. Takes a sideways hop out of bounds at the 22-yard line. 38-yard punt, nothing on the return. Jesse Mahalona, his folks watching back in Kailua, Kona, where it's still in the morning. Notre Dame, all the scoring in the first quarter. Eric Ainge has Cedric Houston as the deep back behind the fullback Corey Anderson. On first down, and here's the play change. Derek Tinsley is in the slot to the left. Hand off, Houston. Into the arms of Brandon Hoyt, number 39. This week, Home Depot's coach's decision. We take a look at Phil Fulmer's decision to rotate his quarterbacks on the final drive versus South Carolina last week.
Yeah, they only had 79 yards of offense with about a couple minutes left. He brought Brent Schaefer in. He had a 55-yard pass. Then they brought Ainge back in. He threw the touchdown. Schaefer back in to go for the two-point conversion. It was the first game that they actually rotated him within the same series, and it really confused the South Carolina defense. Unfortunately, later in that game, Brent Schaefer took a hit and suffered the broken right collarbone, so unavailable today.
Here's Houston. He does not get enough for the first down. Preston Jackson, number 15. It was in the second half that Brent Schaefer, who had a really effective game, was popped and driven down, landed on the collarbone. They're saying 4 to 6 weeks. I know you chatted with him yesterday.
Well, he thinks he might be able to get back a little sooner, maybe back for the SEC championship should Tennessee find their way to Atlanta. And it was really a good game for him because he had not played much or effectively leading up to that game last week. Really gave him a spark against the Gamecocks.
Well, this game somewhat reminiscent. They were down 8-0 to South Carolina last week. They trail 7-3 here, and Houston does get the first down. Tackle made by Derek Curry. So clock 4:10. And it'll start again as soon as the chain is set.
And what Notre Dame and this defense that is senior laden, very smart, not out of position. They have decided they're going to make Eric Ainge and this offense march down the field and earn it by executing several plays. They're not trying not to give up the big play. Make them execute short plays all the way down the field.
Ainge and Robert Meacham takes the inside route. Effectively so. He picks up 13 yards, does number three.
And again, this is good work by Eric Ainge because you've got some talented wideouts who all you have to do is throw them the ball out there in space one-on-one and see if they can make a play. Catch the ball for 5 yards, make a couple guys miss, and turn it into a 12-yard gain. Now that's good high percentage throwing for Eric Ainge and letting your playmakers make plays.
First down and 10 after the 13-yard gain. Here's Ainge. Watch out from behind. Justin Tuck, second sack of the ball game.
He is so quick off the edge, and this time he's working on the other side against Michael Munoz. Watch how quick he is off the ball. Actually, Munoz blocked inside. They tried to use a back, and the back did an ole. You know, the old Matador block.
Oh, did he
just
ever.
Jumped down to the ground, and nobody touched Justin Tuck. I don't like that protection. Their best pass rusher not putting a big guy on him and trying to block him with a back. Not a good percentage.
Yeah, Houston blocked air. Second and 14. Out of the gun. Stunts. Here comes Tuck from the near side. Screen pass. Great play call. Here's Houston trying to make amends. Boy, does he ever. He's on his way. It's a foot race. And it's a touchdown.
Yep.
Tennessee. Dwight Elliott had a chance, but it was just that.
And Cedric Houston stiff-armed him at about the 20-yard line, and that enabled him to separate and get to the end zone. Last week, Houston had runs of 54 and 65 yards, but didn't score on either one. Got caught from behind. This time, he didn't get caught from behind.
That's Trooper Taylor, the running back coach, who will give you a chest bump.
Mm-hmm.
Young man who is still celebrating Baylor's victory over A&M. He played defensive back, did Trooper Taylor. with the Baylor Bears out of Cuero, Texas. Cedric Houston, 56 yards.
Well, good play call by Randy Sanders. Notre Dame creating some problems with their rush. So what do? Take advantage of that aggressive rush, throw a screen pass. And Cedric Houston, with a stiff arm at the end, gets it to the end zone.
And the family Ainge celebrates. Son Eric's touchdown toss.
I want to say it was executed perfectly. It was really more a case of some missed tackles, but Cedric Houston did a great job of running with the football.
James Wilhoit will kick it deep. Shelton Anastasio are the two deep men for Notre Dame. This one taken by Anastasio, goes through his hands. Boy, they have.
I think they need to put two new guys.
I do too.
They got no idea what they're doing.
I'm not too impressed with what they've done so far. Touchdown.
Go back to the touchdown. The guy I want you to keep your eye on is Derrick Curry, this guy right here. He's one of the senior leaders. Now watch as the screen develops out here. He is actually going to miss the block. They're going to try to block him. He's going to step by it, but then he's going to overrun the play. He's in position to make the play, and he runs right by Cedric Houston. And then a couple more missed tackles, and then the stiff arm at the end on Dwight Ehlich that created separation and enabled Houston to take it for the touchdown.
10-7. First down, Brady Quinn, the Irish. Ryan Grant is the deep back as his backs are in the I formation. Quick flip, left side. That's caught by Raymond McKnight out to the 25-yard line. Now Trooper Taylor played for the Cuero Gobblers. He was an outstanding running back. It's a Class 3A school in Texas, and they played for the state championship all 4 years he was there. Trooper Taylor, one of 16 kids. He's an ebullient personality, yes, and he's added a lot to this team. I chatted with him yesterday. His mom, Gloria, is in a hospital in Houston, and he wanted us to pass on his best wishes to her. The Cuero Gobblers. Is that a good one?
That's a great one.
A lot of turkeys there. Knocked down.
Kevin Burnett,
yep,
got his hands on the football. They were coming with a blitz from the edge. And what's happening now, the feeling is that Tennessee is starting to squeeze this Notre Dame offense a little bit. They had success with the short passing game early, and Tennessee's starting to sit on the shorter routes. They're starting to jump in the face of Brady Quinn. I think the tight end, Anthony Fasano, in the middle of the field needs to be the next kind of option, stretching this defense a little bit for Notre Dame.
Irish are 1 of 5 on third downs, only 23 yards in this quarter. Tennessee's turned it around on the other side. Sack. Listen to the crowd.
Turk McBride, he came from a little bit of an outside position that time. And he came quickly. Brady Quinn did not have a chance here. Here's McBride. He's outside. Watch him come inside. He beats his man, the right tackle, Mark Lavore, quickly. And again, Brady Quinn, no chance against that pass rush.
Thus is registered the first three and out for Notre Dame today. Irish will punt when we return. DJ Fitzpatrick to punt for the fifth time.
Very critical part of the half right here for Notre Dame. 2 minutes left. They've got to get a good kick and play solid defense before they head to the locker room.
That's not a great kick. Not at all. Almost lucky that it went sideways.
Yeah.
Because if it goes forward, Derek Tinsley with an excellent chance to get some yardage and a counterpunch. PGA Tour on CBS next weekend. The Franklin Templeton Shootout Saturday at 1 o'clock. The Shark welcomes Mark Calcavecchia, John Daly, Justin Leonard, Mark O'Meara, and our director Steve Milton to the Franklin Templeton Shootout in Naples, Florida next week. 1 o'clock, then Sunday, 1 or 4.
Back-to-back bad punts for Notre Dame. Good field position for Tennessee again as they will try to score right before the half. Could really swing the momentum of the game.
Ainge finds Swain and is out of bounds. And it's time now for the Argent Mortgage quarterback comparison. Peyton Manning, Eric Ainge.
Yeah, both in their freshman years. You can see the one thing that Eric Ainge has really done a nice job of, touchdown passes, 16 to 9 interceptions so far with this and two more games to play. Second in the SEC in touchdown passes behind Chris Leak.
Eric Ainge has a man down the middle, and he throws it behind him.
Well, the receiver never looked for the ball. Tony Brown, number 81, is running down the middle of the field. And I don't know if Eric was throwing it to him or not, but he never looked for it. They tried to split the Notre Dame defense. First time they've thrown it down the field, and Tony Brown, it was behind him a little bit, but it didn't look like he expected the ball to come his way. And now it's third down and 10 for Eric Ainge.
And Tom Zbikowski, who had that huge play against Michigan State, a fumble return of 78 yards, almost picked that one off. It would have been his second interception of the season. Here's the inside reverse to Derek Tinsley, and he stumbles and falls. It'll be fourth down in Notre Dame, and Tinsley is looks like he's injured.
Yeah, because he went down awkwardly. I thought if he would have kept his feet, he might have picked up the first down. And this is a big stop for Notre Dame. Again, they want to try to keep momentum. A little misdirection draw. They start action one way, and I think if Tinsley stays on his feet, he might make the first down. It was well executed, well blocked out there, but Tinsley went down very awkwardly.
Notre Dame called timeout, and the medical staff tends to Derek Tinsley. We'll take a break. Can't get back. It will affect the punt returning circumstance for Tennessee. Here's Colquitt. He had a great punt last time.
Another great one.
Yes, it is.
Unreturnable.
That's terrific. Yard punt, nothing on the return. And the concern is with Derek Tinsley.
He's a real versatile guy for Tennessee. You know, he can play wide receiver, he can run the football. You mentioned the punt returning ability. He's kind of a little bit of an overlooked or forgotten guy in this Tennessee offense because he can do a lot of different things.
Well, we're 1:26 away from the Earthlink halftime report back in New York with Tim Spencer and Tony Barnhart. Here's the injury again, Todd.
Yeah, he came off looking at his left knee. I hope that's not a serious injury. Notre Dame now with a minute 26, all three of their timeouts left.
Gaither coming on the blitz. He's clipped. Not that he was clipped legally. I mean, he was knocked down, and there's a quick pass by Brady Quinn out to Raymond McKnight, a pickup of 12. Jason Allen with the tackle.
And a nice little changeup, a different route, the first slant route that they've thrown. Again, Tennessee starting to squeeze on some of the short routes. See Notre Dame try to throw it down the field a little bit more here.
Here's Quinn dancing out of trouble, being chased by Mahalona. Travis Thomas, who comes on the field, number 26, is the third running back in the rotation, gets the pass from Brady Quinn. Travis Thomas, second down and 8, 1:09 to go. In the first quarter, Notre Dame was averaging at 11.3 yards per play. It's come down considerably.
Now the Tennessee front has started to step up, and they've used their athleticism and their speed to create some problems. And Tyrone Willingham said he thought this defensive front the most athletic they've seen since Michigan State, and he even gives them the nod as the best defensive front that his team will have played this season. And they're starting to assert themselves a little bit here in the second quarter.
Second down and 8, draw play. Thomas tripped up. Mahalona. Clock shows 1 minute to go.
You know, I think it's amazing. Here he is. Watch how quick he explodes off the ball and trips up the ball carrier. This guy came from junior college, and he had a knee injury, and everybody thought he wouldn't play. He said, I'm not going to miss any games. I'm here for 2 years, and I'm going to play every minute I can.
Notre Dame with one timeout left. Tennessee also third down and 10. In a 10-7 game, the difference, a 56-yard pass. Eric Ainge, Cedric Houston. Here's Quinn with time. Throws it away on fourth down.
They tried to throw a screen over to Marcus Wilson. It was very well defended.
Two flags down.
Well, They were setting up a screen pass, and it was diagnosed well by Tennessee. I think they may be calling intentional grounding.
That's
on Brady
what I was
Quinn.
Wondering, yeah.
We have two fouls in the play. Ineligible receiver downfield on the offense, number 76. That penalty is going to be declined. Intentional grounding on quarterback number 10. Well, it was in the pocket area, threw the ball when there was no eligible receiver at all. That'll be a spot foul, loss of down, fourth down.
Well, this really works in Tennessee's favor because not only does it stop the clock, it forces the punt. It backs Notre Dame up some more. See, the problem and the confusion I have a little bit is you're allowed to have linemen downfield on a screen. They're allowed to get back as long as the ball's thrown behind the line of scrimmage. But because the ball was thrown past the line of scrimmage, that necessitated the ineligible man downfield.
Tinsley is out. Jonathan Hefney will return the punt. 13-yard loss in the penalty. DJ Fitzpatrick has hit two poor punts in a row. Keep it at two. This is a good one. Hefney. Flag down. In the season opener a couple of months ago, two flags down. He returned a punt 57 yards for a touchdown, but it was wiped out by a penalty. That's an 11-yard return, and apparently the infraction will be called against the Volunteers.
I think they're going to get Corey Larkin for a block in the back on one of the gunners running down there for Notre Dame.
Legal block in the back on the return team, number 23. 10-yard penalty for the spinal foul.
Seconds to go. Well, our little traveling entourage will move down to Auburn. And this is a game of some consequence next week.
Yes, it is.
Georgia, big win today, 62-17. Auburn taking time off this week, getting ready for Georgia, no doubt with some eyes cast on the Oklahoma-Texas A&M game.
Absolutely. Auburn number three in the BCS right now behind USC and Oklahoma.
And Georgia, of course, thought it might get a break from South Carolina last week. They need help to get to overcome Tennessee, because one of the impressive victories this season was Tennessee's 19-14 win at Georgia. And we continue to look at scores of importance. Here's the big one, fellas. Texas Lutheran, the mighty Bulldogs, defeat Sol Ross 38-14. Todd, that is
our... You are just so proud.
That's our seventh win in a row, the American Southwest Conference. Yeah, I really am.
Yeah, that's great.
They gave up football for a while. Jim Wacker, the late Jim Wacker, was the head coach at TLU back in the 70s. Fumble. And Ainge is going to be sacked.
Boy, was that an ugly looking play.
Yes, it was.
Good for Tennessee, it was the last play of the half, because that one was ugly. Ainge is still down, though, at the end of the play.
Oh, boy.
This play was disastrous. It was a bad shotgun snap. I'm surprised they were even in the shotgun, unless they were just going to try to throw a Hail Mary or just throw it up. But it was a bad shotgun snap by Chuck Prue. And Eric Ainge is still on the ground as the teams move the locker room. Watch the shotgun snap. Low and at his feet. And then as he goes down, he doesn't. Boy, oh boy.
Brandon Hoyt, number 39.
Watch how he comes down. He comes down awkwardly on his right elbow and shoulder with Brandon Hoyt on top of him, and then he reaches right for the right shoulder.
Well, Brent Schaefer with a broken collarbone last week. Eric Ainge, the backup, is Rick Clawson, Casey Clawson's younger brother, who started his career at LSU, has not played here. He sat out last year, and Tracy Wolfson will obviously get a report. That's the family Ainge. That's Dougie's dad, his sister Kimberly right next to his dad. That's her roommate Kara Duffy, and there's mom Diane. And let's go down to Tracy Wilson with Philip Fulmer.
Thanks a lot, Vern. A good sign. We just saw Eric Ainge walk off the field. Can you tell us what happened to him?
No, they're going to look at his shoulder. I hope it's okay, obviously.
a tough situation if that's the case with Brent Schaefer being out. What do you do? Do you go to Clawson, and how comfortable are you with him?
Yeah, Rick, if that's the case, Rick will be the guy.
Thanks a lot. Vern, back to you.
All right, Tracy. It'll be a long 20 minutes in that locker room.
And interesting to point out, Clawson didn't get many reps this week, but the coaches assured us he's the kind of guy that needs mental reps and not necessarily physical reps. He might be the guy in the second half.
Eric Ainge downed. Philip Fulmer says maybe the shoulder. That's the end of the half. Let's go to Tim Brando in New York. And he didn't take many snaps at all this week. Here's the kick from Jenks, and it's Corey Larkins to return. That one will come back to the 20. And let's get more from Tracy Wolfson.
Thanks, Vern. I spoke to the Tennessee trainers to get more on Eric Ainge. X-rays were taken in the locker room. He has a shoulder separation of the AC joint. He will be evaluated further throughout the week. Back to you, Vern.
All right, thank you, Tracy.
And the problem for Tennessee is you say, well, we got to lean on a running game. Well, they only ran the ball for 46 yards and an average of 2 yards per carry in the first half. So they still are going to have to find ways to make some plays throwing the football. But now they're going to have to do it with Rick Clawson.
There's the first snap for Rick Clawson. Clawson. We get a little situated here. Lots of wires in this business, in case you couldn't tell. Well, this is really, it's stunned this crowd, hasn't it?
It really has. It's unfortunate, but as Philip Fulmer said going into halftime, one of the real marks of this team all year has been when injured players go down, new guys have stepped up. And now it's on the shoulders of Rick Clawson, and they're going to have to throw the football.
Second down and 7. They'll keep it on the ground again. This is Houston. Out to the 26. Well, last week against South Carolina, this was Brent Schaefer, one of the two true freshman quarterbacks on this team. Broken collarbone, 4 to 6 weeks for Brent Schaefer, the young man from Deerfield Beach, and now the young man from Hillsboro, Oregon, with a separated shoulder, and as Tracy just told you, will be evaluated daily. And this crowd has really become stunned by what happened.
Now I'm interested to see if Notre Dame changes their tactics. They played a lot of zone with three-man rush against Eric Ainge. Will they stay with the same philosophy against Clawson?
Low snap, drop ball. C.J. Faiton, number 17, and so it'll be 4th down and 4, and Tennessee will go on defense. The first half stats presented by the Hartford. 10-7 the score.
Yeah, pretty even statistically. You see the rushing yards, neither team. I think the second half now will come down to three big things. Who can run the ball at all? Who turns the ball over? There were no turnovers in that first half. And big plays, plays of over 25 yards. Tennessee had 2 in the first half, Notre Dame 1. This game is going to be a defensive struggle. Who allows a big play?
Dustin Colquitt has had a spectacular game after a lackluster season, but this is not one of his better efforts.
Oh, my goodness.
That's really poor, as a matter of fact. 31-yard punt. Notre Dame and Tennessee meeting for the 7th time. Neyland Stadium, the announced crowd today, 107,266. First score was a field goal, Will Hoyt. Then Brady Quinn tossed a touchdown pass to his tight end to make it 7-3. Eric Ainge found Cedric Houston 56 yards for the go-ahead score. But the big news, separated shoulder, Eric Ainge, as he couldn't find a snap out of the spread on the final play of the first half. He is out of this game and maybe out for much longer. Here's the toss. It comes to Ryan Grant out near the 50-yard line.
Very positive sign that time for the Notre Dame offense as you look at what they did offensively in the first half. Never like to see all those groups of punts together. This team had 141 yards in the first quarter, only 18 yards of total offense in the second quarter as the Tennessee defensive front four really asserted itself in the second quarter. But a good run on first down to start this drive.
Second down and 2. It's Ryan Grant, senior from Nyack, New York. That's John Carlson, the tight end. Left side, Grant.
Nothing.
It'll be 3rd and short. Kevin Burnett with the tackle, number two.
Kevin Burnett, that's his seventh tackle of the ball game. He and Jason Allen have been the two leaders of this defense. Pair of captains. Coming in, Allen, the leader in tackles with 83. Burnett right behind him with 74. They're leading the team today.
Third and two. Rashawn Powers Neal is the fullback, short man in the eye. Grant, the running back. And to Grant, looks like he's got the first down at the 46-yard line. Tackle made by Jason Allen. And again, Notre Dame needs this game. They need a victory, yeah, either today or next week against Pittsburgh, or much less likely, the final game out against Southern Cal on the coast to become bowl eligible.
And the thing why this game is so important, to not only obviously try to win, but to play well, is that game 2 weeks ago, they let get away. I mean, I don't mean that in any disrespectful way to Boston College, but Notre Dame should have won that game handily, and they didn't.
Quinn, caught by the fullback, Rashawn Powers Neal, and then he is caught by Jonathan Heffney, number 33.
And just go back to that. Normally you don't like to go into an open week following a loss, but I think Notre Dame needed to have that open week because of the way they lost. They were winning 20-7 at halftime. Boston College dominated the second half and threw a 30-yard touchdown pass with 54 seconds left to beat them 24-23 in South Bend. They would not have been able to recover from that loss and play the next week very effectively. They needed those extra days to get ready for this game.
And you see how well they have done in the last 20 years after an off week. Here's Grant coming left inside the 40 to the 39. It's going to give Notre Dame another third down. Jason Mitchell and Kevin Burnett with the tackles. Kevin Burnett, in his senior season, missed all year 2 years ago. Serious knee injury. Came back last year. Thought about making himself available for the NFL draft, but didn't feel he had played that well. He's a wonderful young man. Twice a captain of this team. Spent the summer working with fatherless boys in an outfit called Team First with Mike Gottfried because he lost his father at the age of seven. He's having a terrific season. Darius Walker is the running back on third down and four. Here's Quinn, pressure, incomplete. In the middle, Jason Mitchell, number 35.
Hard to do anything if you're a quarterback when the pressure comes right up inside. Watch Jason Mitchell come right up into the face, or rather the chest of Brady Quinn. Nobody picks him up on the quick blitz inside, and Brady Quinn just has to hang in there and try to make a throw.
That's going to bring on DJ Fitzpatrick again, and Jonathan Heffney is back to return the punt if it becomes available.
Field position here. You got to be thinking, pin them down with the new quarterback in the game.
Heffney will let it go. It's touched by Notre Dame. Now he touched the ball out at the 11-yard line. It stops.
And he actually tried to catch it,
yeah,
in the air on the 11. Definitely didn't want it to go into the end zone, so I don't fault him for doing that, but they could have downed it inside the five had he let it go.
And now it's ruled the contact came at the 14-yard line. That was John Brockington, number 52. 25-yard punt.
You know, the worst thing you could do right here is let it bounce into the end zone because you're trying to down it on the one. And Brockington, in this case, may have been able to let it go a little further.
10-7, Eric Ainge out. Second look at Rick Clawson when we come back.
Welcome back to Knoxville. The injuries are mounting for this Tennessee team. As we mentioned numerous times, quarterback Eric Ainge is out for the game with a separated shoulder. In addition to Ainge, punt returner and wide receiver Derek Tinsley is also out for the game with a left lower leg fracture. Cornerback Jonathan Wade has a right ankle sprain. He is doubtful to return. Wide receiver Brett Smith and wide receiver Robert Meacham should return. Meacham has a shoulder sprain. Smith is out with a knee sprain. Back to you, Ron.
Oh, boy. Here's Clawson with a handoff. Houston bounces back to his left into the hands of Derek Curry, a D The offensive line was banged up coming into this one, and now the wide receivers are getting it.
And you made the point that this is the eighth consecutive week that Tennessee has played football. And at this time of the year, everybody, every team in America is banged up. I mean, everybody gets nicked and bruised at this point in the season. Notre Dame played eight straight weeks and then had last week off. Tennessee will get a week off after this game, but they are falling fast for the guys in orange today.
Second down and nine, a gain of one on the last play. Here's Clawson, Rick Clawson, Junior, first action he's seen at Tennessee.
Nope.
Here's Clawson, wings it, right side. That's Robert Meacham, number three, who makes the catch and gets it out to the 20-yard line. Well, Clawson listed as the third-string quarterback. C.J. Leak and Rick Clawson at the beginning of fall practice in August were battling it out for the lead spot. They went with the two 18-year-olds. Bo Hardigree, now a freshman, is listed as the backup to Rick Clawson.
Yeah, C.J.'s not even playing offense anymore.
No.
He's playing defense, linebacker. And a lot of zeros on that chart.
And here again, the play clock winding under five, third and four. Clawson back, flips it out, caught. First down, Cedric Houston out to the 31-yard line. That's a gain of 11.
Now the good news for Rick Clawson is he still, even with the injuries, they still have some playmakers on this Tennessee offense. Get the ball in the hands of your playmaker. One of them is Gerald Riggs. And he picks up a nice block from a receiver, Robert Meacham, out here, that he was able to slip inside and get the first down. Here's Robert Meacham. Tracy mentioned he's banged up, but he came in and did a little banging of his own on that play.
Houston with a catch in the first down. It's a first down 10 at the 32-yard line. And they'll try the reverse. This is Chris Hannon.
Very well played by Preston Jackson. I mean, he stayed right at home. Again, this is a defense that is very experienced. 9 out of 11 of the starters are seniors. And they don't get themselves out of position very often. Now, they might get beat athletically from time to time, but they don't get themselves out of position.
Second and 10, no gain on the reverse. Jason Swain, wide to the left. It's Houston again. And again, they don't run. Well,
Goolsby has been all over.
Yes.
I think that's his 10th tackle of the ball game. And the middle linebacker, again, a senior out of Joliet Catholic over in Illinois, having a big ball game today.
Third and 12.
When I was in South Bend, I saw him. He was coming late to practice because he had a class, and he was riding his bicycle in full uniform on his way over to the indoor facility.
Gerald Riggs back in, third and 12. Three wides, two running backs. Play fake, Clawson back, steps up, caught.
Oh, boy.
Intercepted, picked off by Goolsby, and he will score. Tipped by Landry, intercepted by Goolsby. Touchdown, Notre Dame, 26 yards.
Even though Rick Clawson is a junior, he has not played much football at the major college level. This is a mistake of inexperience to even throw this ball. The defense won on that play. Take the sack, punt the football, and try to play defense. Don't force it when you're going down.
Notre Dame reclaims the lead, and they tack on the extra point. That is the first turnover of the ball game, and Mike Goolsby gets the touchdown.
Again, tremendous pressure by the Notre Dame front three. I mean, they're rushing three. That's all that's coming, and they're just collapsing the pocket on the quarterback. Now, Clawson, never throw that ball. Just take the sack and take your chances on defense. Instead, Goolsby with another huge play for the Irish.
Number 66 made it happen. Derek Landry with the near sack. 6:46 to go, third quarter. The Irish celebrating. Fighting Irish Band, and Mike Goolsby, who gets his first career touchdown Linebacker who sat out all of last season with an injury, second interception of his career, first time he has scored.
And first turnover of this football game, and it was crucial.
This is a short kick by Jenks. It'll be taken by Corey Larkins at the 10. And he gets it to the 22-yard line. So Rob Woods with the tackle, and Rick Clawson comes on for the third series of the half.
Well, I want to look back at this play now. Let's watch it wide as Rick Clawson goes back to throw. There is nobody open for Tennessee. He's not open. He's not open. He's double covered. He's covered. So at that point, Rick Clawson has to realize, hey, the defense won. I can't force the ball here. Let's punt the football. But he tries to throw it. I'm not even sure where he was trying to throw it. And it ended up being a costly, costly error.
Maybe at Corey Anderson, but Anderson was facing the other direction. Now Riggs is in as the tailback. Anderson the fullback. The toss to Riggs coming right. And gang tackling. Trevor Laws and Tom Zbikowski. Let's go back to the studio for a Pontiac game-changing performance. Here's Tim.
You bet, Vern, and it is game-changing. Opening kick, Texas A&M in the second half fumbles. Oklahoma gets it two plays later. Mark Bradley on the receiving end of this Jason White touchdown. It's tied at 28. Back to Vern.
Oh.
That one's not over.
No.
Not with the returning Heisman candidate and one of the front runners for this year in the same backfield.
Tennessee keeps it on the ground. It's Gerald Riggs, number 31. Limited to 25 yards in last week's win over South Carolina with a hip pointer. And Cedric Houston came on and had the big game, 190 yards. But Riggs has played quite well this year.
He has. And he's had a great attitude. You know, in the past, he's had a little bit of a reputation of not being very coachable, having a little bit of an attitude, not being a great team guy, but he has really stepped up this year and has played excellent football.
Third series this half, third time Tennessee's faced a third down. Here's the handoff, and the third time they won't get a first down.
Boy, I am impressed with this Notre Dame front seven, and particularly their down people are really solid. I mean, you know, we obviously don't see them very much. And I got to watch some tape of their last three games. And this group up here, they are stout. I mean, they don't get pushed out of there. And we know this is a pretty good Tennessee offensive line, and they are not able to get a push on this Notre Dame defense. 29 rushes, 59 yards now for Tennessee, only 2 yards per carry.
There's Kent Bayer, the defensive coordinator, a player at Utah State in the early 70s. He was a defensive coordinator at Cal and Arizona State before joining Ty Willingham's team at Stanford. And here is the punt. So Kent Bayer quite pleased with his defensive effort. He was 23 years old when he graduated from Utah State, accepted a job as the athletic director and head coach of the Yokosuka Seahawks, home of the 7th Fleet in Tokyo Bay. Said he learned quite a bit. Some of it he's applied to his job. Goldsby with a go-ahead touchdown. It's 14-10 now. Eric Ainge, if you joined us late, separated shoulder, final play of the first half. Rick Clawson came on, was intercepted. Goldsby, touchdown. Now it's in the hands, if you're a Tennessee fan, of this Volunteer defense.
And I think that's where it needs to be. They're going to be limited offensively the rest of the way. This defense needs to step up and make some plays.
That's a pretty good start. Jesse Mahalona, number 55, from Kailua Kona, Hawaii.
He's powerful, 6'2", 300, built low to the ground, and very quick off the football. He sheds the guard, the center can't pick him up, and it's a tackle behind the line of scrimmage. One of the leaders in the SEC in that category.
Second and 11. Walker, still the running back. Jason Allen hustles up, makes sure the defensive call is understood. Four-man rush, Walker. Guess who? Jesse Mahalona. He's a refreshing young man.
He is. He
got a chance to spend a little time with him yesterday. Loves to play this game.
Well, he originally was going to go to the University of Hawaii, but his SAT scores weren't high enough. But he hung around the program and worked out, and he didn't really like it. And so he decided to go to junior college and try to get recruited somewhere else. And he ended up coming all the way to East Tennessee to play for the Volunteers.
Also visited Oklahoma. Came here last year when the Volunteers were playing Mississippi State. Here's the snap on third down. Quinn across the middle. Dropped. Tennessee gets it back. It was dropped by the former quarterback, Carlisle Holiday.
And pressure again. Three plays in a row. Jesse Mahalona took this defense, put it on his broad shoulders, and set the tempo. Three plays in a row by the defensive tackle, Jesse Mahalona.
Fourth down. And the eighth punt of DJ Fitzpatrick. He's averaged just under 40 per kick. Jonathan Hefney at the 35.
A big chance for Tennessee to flip field position here with any kind of a return.
High snap, short punt. Fair catch, Hefney at the 40.
That was a bad snap. Fitzpatrick got a pretty good kick out of that, considering how the snap came back to him.
Big series by a big man, Mahalona, Tennessee's ball. Just over 107,000 gathered at ancient Neyland Stadium, Tennessee, trailing Notre Dame 14-10. Two significant plays in this game, the most significant of which was the injury to Eric Ainge, final play, first half.
Yeah, separated right shoulder. Last play of the half. A very costly injury. Now we're down to Rick Clawson.
And the second play of significance was Rick Clawson's third down pass. It was intercepted for a touchdown. He's going deep. And he's got a man. And it's caught at the 21-yard line by Robert Meacham. Over Dwight Ellick.
Nice call by Randy Sanders, the offensive coordinator. They're not going to run on this Notre Dame defense. They're not going to be able to wear them down. They've got to get some big plays out of their passing game. And they get one here with Robert Meacham. Single coverage on Ellick, perfectly thrown by Clawson over the outside shoulder. Very difficult to defend, and Tennessee in scoring territory with one play.
Younger brother of Casey Clawson led his team to the SEC championship in 2001. Here's the
pass. Here's a pass, too.
It looked like it was going to be.
Dwight Ellick had his man covered. He didn't bite on the fake, and so that's the reason that Riggs had to run the football. But Riggs was going to throw this football. Take a look at the replay here. They're going to try to throw the ball on the streak here. When Riggs comes this way, he sees that Ellick was not fooled by the fake, stayed with his man deep, and Riggs had to turn it into a running play. Again, good discipline by the Notre Dame defense.
Second down, six at the 17. Late third quarter, Volunteers, like five other teams, have had trouble running against Notre Dame. Five times they've held teams to under 100 yards. Here's Clawson, screen pass, Riggs. He's in trouble. And he's tackled near the line of scrimmage by Brandon Hoyt, number 39. This is Hoyt, who in a previous CBS telecast against Navy had 16 tackles in that game. And it's third down and five. Tennessee loads him up right side. Three receivers to the right, one to the left. Blitz, Clawson, batted down.
Derrick Curry. Got his hand on it. He just was in a little floating position reading the quarterback. He wasn't rushing. He was off the line of scrimmage, and he just read the quarterback and then timed his jump. Here he is right here. Watch him read Clawson's eyes and time his jump perfectly. Now, Clawson had a guy open for the first down. If he's able to get that pass through there, Brett Smith catches it for a first down. Nice play.
That's going to bring on James Wilhoit, second field goal attempt of the ball game. This one from 33 yards out. John Henderson is the holder. Scott Newsom snaps it back. The kick is up. They got three out of the drive, the highlight of which was a 39-yard pass from Rick Clawson to Robert Meacher. 14-13. 1:28 to go third.
Welcome back to Knoxville, Tennessee, trailing by one. Quarterback Eric Ainge is still in the locker room. I spoke with his mother, Diane. She said Eric's father is with him right now in the locker room. We have no further update on his medical condition. They are hoping for the best, but they understand these things happen. Fortunately, with the off week up next, they will get a chance to rest at home. He's headed back to Oregon to spend some much needed time with his family. Back to you, Vern.
All right, thank you, Trace.
So important, Tennessee capitalized. That was the best field position they've had in the whole game. They got the one big pass and they got points on the board. Very important to capitalize when they had that chance.
Will Hoyt knocks it 9 yards deep on the checkerboard. Well, this is the celebration of the very first college football game. New Brunswick, New Jersey, November 6th, 1869. 6-4, the final score.
That score sounds familiar to me.
Well, that was Princeton and Rutgers, and it seems to me that Iowa and Penn State played 6-4 recently. The modern version of the first game. 135 years of college football. And these two teams have provided much of the legacy of this wonderful sport. Notre Dame. Tennessee.
Well, Rick Clawson hit a big pass play for Tennessee. Brady Quinn's going to have to do that in this second half for them to hold on to win this game. They're not going to run it down Tennessee's throat either.
Here's Ryan Grant out to the 25. Well, I would argue, of course, the most notable of all the great Notre Dame coaches would be Newt Rockne. Bob Nealon here. We're working on a program on the top 10 coaches, and I was in Chicago the other day. These are actual notes from Amos Alonzo's day. Practice Ecky on receiving the ball from center with one hand held above the other. The advantage, slightly less chance of a fumble. He was talking about Walter Eckersall. That message written to himself on October 13th, 1903. It was the beginning of the center snap. Think about Eric Ainge taking a snap from spread and bobbling the ball back in the end of the first half. Well, how do you do? Carlton Neal grew up in Chicago, wanted to play for Notre Dame, wasn't recruited there.
This game was important to him. He didn't bite on the bootleg fake. He held his ground. Anthony Fasano, the tight end, trying to get out around him, but very well played from a discipline standpoint by Carlton Neal. He said, hey, this is my opportunity this week. Last week in South Carolina, the guys from South Carolina played well. This one is my time.
Volunteers and the Fighting Irish are going to allow the clock to expire at the end of three. That's the end of the third quarter with our score 14-13, Notre Dame. We'll return to Neyland Stadium right after these messages and a word from your local station. We begin the final 15, Neyland Stadium in Knoxville. The orange-clad volunteer squad urging its defense on. Third and 13, Notre Dame at the 17-yard line. Derek Curry holding the chain that symbolizes the strength of his Notre Dame defense.
Notre Dame 2 of 10 only on third down today.
Here's Quinn. Takes a lot of time. Good downfield coverage. Runs into the umpire. And give the umpire an assist on the tackle. That was Percy Munn and Corey Larkins, who should share the tackle.
Yep. Good coverage downfield. Brady Quinn had time to throw. Nowhere to go, and then nowhere to run either. Only 30 yards of offense for Notre Dame since that first quarter when they had 118. The Tennessee defense has really asserted itself. Look at that by the quarter.
E.J. Fitzpatrick on to punt again. Fourth and 12. Jonathan Hefney with Derek Tinsley out with a fractured leg will return this one, and it is returnable. at the 42. Gets a good block and a clean block, but then fine pursuit by the Notre Dame special teams limit the return to 4 yards off the 40-yard punt. There's a flag back at the line of scrimmage.
A game like this becomes a game of field position. It becomes a game of turnovers and who can create some big plays.
Well, let's see if this is a post-possession call here.
Holding on the return team, number 42. It's going to be a 10-yard penalty from where the kick ended. First down.
Okay. But possession remains Tennessee's.
And still decent field position for the Volunteers. They had their best field position on their last offensive series.
Robert Boulware is able to smile. His team trailing by one, 14-13. Time call. Darkness has enveloped Knoxville, Tennessee. The bright lights illuminating this playing field as Philip Fulmer's team tries to climb from behind. They have scored 71 points in the fourth quarter this season, the most in the SEC. First down and 10, Rick Clawson on for the injured Eric Ainge. Fires it out behind the intended receiver. And that's going to leave Tennessee with the second down. Well, we've seen them much this season. Against Florida, they won with 6 seconds left. Georgia on the road, Ole Miss. You see, it was a late come from behind. Alabama and South Carolina last week. What tactics, Todd, should these coaches be employing now?
Well, the game has become a defensive game, a game of field position, but I still think you've got to coach it to win and not coach it to not lose the game. When you get your opportunities and field position, you've got to take some shots to make some big plays. And that's, I think, what it's going to come down to for both of these offenses, making a couple big plays.
Clawson, there's one. That's Chris Hannon, number 13. And that is a 14-yard gain.
How much confidence does Rick Clawson have after that long pass to Meacham? A lot. He steps back. He fires the slant. And they move the chains. And now, again, Tennessee with excellent field position right here on this possession.
Trailing by one, 14-13. And here's Clawson with the change after he looks over Randy Sanders on the far side. Cedric Houston across the 50, bobbled the ball. Is it loose? Let's see. Houston appears to have it.
You know, one of the things that we heard all week out of the Tennessee camp was this idea of respect and how important this game was for respect. They've done what they needed to do in the SEC, except for the one loss to Auburn. They control their own destiny, but now they've stepped outside of the SEC East, and they recognize that a chance to play Notre Dame and beat them maybe would get them some of the respect nationwide as not only an SEC contender, but a national championship contender would give them.
Here's the toss. Houston to the 43. Crowd anticipating a big break on that play. It almost happened.
Take a look. Good blocks by the fullback Corey Anderson and Albert Tuina, the right tackle in there. Tennessee has not had much success running the football, but that was a positive play for Cedric Houston.
And that is a first down and 10 at the 43-yard line. And Rick Clawson has called a timeout. He'll go over and chat with Randy Sanders, who doesn't look any too pleased at the fact they had to call the timeout. 14-13. Notre Dame. And Tennessee. Eric Ainge out with a separated shoulder. Rick Clawson, transfer from LSU, younger brother of the four-year starter Casey Clawson here at Tennessee. 5 of 9. The big play was a 39-yard pass that set up the only score for Tennessee in this half. That was a field goal by James Wilhoit. Here's Clawson back. Drills it wide open. C.J. Faton, another drop.
You know, I was talking about how important Tennessee felt this game was for respect. And one of the things that they were upset about is the fact that they beat Georgia, and yet Georgia is ranked ahead of them. And in the other coaches' poll, Tennessee's down here. They're number 11, and Georgia's way up here. And they went to Athens and beat Georgia. And so they said, hey, we've done what we needed to do, but nobody's respecting us. They saw this game as a chance to make a real statement for respect.
They trail by one now with their starting quarterback out for the game. Here's Clawson. That's Gerald Riggs, number 31. Down to the 36. Kevin Burnett, the senior captain, one of six, this is what he had to say. We're not getting a whole lot of respect with us beating Alabama, Florida, Georgia, South Carolina. Just a respect game for us, talking about this one. We feel we've been disrespected lately in the last couple of weeks. We just want to go out there, put together a complete Tennessee football game.
Could be one of the biggest plays, if not the biggest play of the game right here for Tennessee. They may, you never know when they're going to be in this part of the field again with a little under 12 minutes to go in the game.
Third and three, Riggs is the tailback, and Riggs gets the handoff, cuts to his right, struggles. He is wrapped up by Brandon Hoyt, number 39, who is having another big game for Notre Dame.
Boy, it looked like he might have slipped out of this. Again, a well-disciplined Notre Dame defense. Riggs not able to slip out of the shoestring tackle of Brandon Hoyt.
Fourth and one, 11:18 to go, trailing by one at home. Philip Fulmer says, let's try for the first down.
Well, part of that might be that James Wilhoit from this distance is 2 of 6 on the season. Not his best range.
High formation. Riggs is the deep back. He gets the handoff. Squirts. Don't either. And it's Brandon Hoyt again.
I don't think he got it. And actually, I thought Tennessee moved on the play before the snap, but there was no penalty call. But I do not think he got it. I think there was movement on the right side of the Tennessee line that was not flagged. But regardless, I don't think they made the first down.
Brandon Hoyt. 9 today. They will bring the chain and check.
It's not even close.
Nope.
Now watch this play again. What a stand by the Fighting Irish defense. I think there was movement right here by Tolina before the snap. Wasn't called, but no movement up front on that right side. And Brandon Hoyt, the linebacker, along with Zibakowski, the safety, able to come in there and make the play.
Fighting Irish get it back. Just a footnote, they've not turned the ball over today. Well, we've got a moment to present this week's Scholar Athlete presented by Red Lobster. Chose not to have him try the long field goal, but James Wilhoit is our Scholar Athlete, sophomore with a 3.61 grade point average and academic All-SEC last year. James Wilhoit, Red Lobster's commitment to the investment of our future is shown today by donating $1,000 to Tennessee's General Scholarship Fund.
I think the burden now for Notre Dame is really on their offense. Their defense just came up with a huge stop. Even if they don't score points, they need to kill some clock, move the football, and at the very least, flip field position for their defense.
There's the reverse to Carter. Oh, they fake the reverse, and Quinn goes deep. And he's got Shelton down there and overthrows him.
And there, I'll tell you what, Shelton was held on that play, and it was not called. Shelton was blatantly held on that play-action pass, and it was not called. I think it was Jonathan Hefney that held him because he was beat, and they did not call it. Matt Shelton with great speed. Watch on the play-action fake. He's just going to get grabbed by Hefney, and that is a blatant hold that was not called on Jonathan Hefney.
And as a result, it's a second down and 10. Darius Walker is the running back now behind Quinn. Walker darts to the left, tries to get outside. He's ridden out of bounds by Kevin Burnett and Jonathan Heffney. And leave Notre Dame looking at a third down.
Big third down opportunity right here for Brady Quinn. Again, they've got to let their defense rest. They've only converted 2 of 11 third downs in the ball game. This one is critical. They need to work the clock. They need to hold the football, let their defense rest, and they need to flip field position.
Eric Ainge back on the sideline with a separated shoulder. Talks to his teammates. Seeing that his mom and dad, his sister here. Separated shoulder, final play, first half, third down here. Quinn back. Quinn pressure. Throws it out, caught by his tight end, Fasano.
They were lucky to get that play off. The play clock was down to one when they snapped. It looked like they were a little bit hurried. Justin Harrell with good pressure on Quinn, but he's able to elude the pressure long enough to find his tight end. Throwing it on the move, and a much-needed third down conversion, only their third of the day. This front four for Tennessee that has gotten better and better as the weeks have gone in this season, putting pressure on Brady Quinn.
Fasano got 8 yards on the pass. First down, Quinn. He's now 12 of 21 in the ballgame. 118 yards. Toss. Walker. Ouch. Jesse Mahalona. Mahalona, who has been a big, big presence on defense. And Notre Dame, three plays. Previous three possessions.
Punt, punt, punt. And I don't stutter.
It's one of the things I admire you about. One of many.
Appreciate that.
14-13, under 10. Notre Dame trying to become bowl eligible. Tennessee trying to get respect. Keep their aspirations of a bowl championship series bowl alive. On the loose, here's Darius Walker. Weaves all the way to the right side.
What a run. A great run by Darius Walker, making a guy miss in the hole. Carlton Neal had him dead to rights, unblocked, and he just left him sprawled out on the turf and then cut it all the way back across the field for the first down. Excellent running inside by Darius Walker to make a guy miss and then break it to the outside.
Darius Walker from Lawrenceville, Georgia, where he broke Herschel Walker's career touchdown rushing record in Georgia high school annals. Did not play in the loss to Brigham Young that opened the season when the Irish picked up 11 yards rushing. He came on and had 115 in their big win against Michigan. Play fake. Quinn deep down the middle for Shelton. Tipped, incomplete. And let's check in with Tracy Wolfson with Doug Ainge.
That's right, Vern. I'm here with Eric Ainge's father, Doug. Doug, can you clarify what the situation is with Eric and his shoulder?
Yeah, he's got a where the collarbone connects to the shoulder, the connective tissue came loose, so we don't know how long he'll be out.
You've been with him in the locker room. What are his spirits like?
Eric's really discouraged. I mean, he wants to win this game, and he's really discouraged.
What kind of advice did you give him?
He chose to play this game, and it's a physical game, and so it was a clean hit. Part of the game. I told him to hang in there. We said a prayer. He'll be fine.
Thanks a lot, Doug. We wish him well. Vern, back to you.
Tracy, thank you. That is a very sad sight. Look at those two young men.
Both
Brent Schaefer, Eric Ainge. Such excitement before the season began when Philip Fulmer declared the two 18-year-olds from opposite cultures and opposite parts of the country co-starters for Tennessee. And here they are, both injured late in the year.
And meanwhile, another huge run from Notre Dame, this time Ryan Grant. We saw Walker with a big run for a first down. That time it was Ryan Grant. And how important would a field goal be here for Notre Dame? Three more points would make Tennessee have to score a touchdown instead of a field goal to win the game.
On first down, Ryan Grant down to the 22-yard line. Justin Harrell, number 92, makes the tackle.
If you're wondering about DJ Fitzpatrick, his long for the season, a 47-yarder, 3 of 4 between 40 and 49-yard attempts. He had a very costly missed PAT, his only one of the season, last year against BC in the game they lost 24-23.
And what a timely drive this has been.
Yes, that exactly what they needed, not only for their offense, but for their defense that's played so well today.
Grant, the deep back in the eye. Here comes the blitz. Grant gets the handoff. Forced outside and tackled at the 23.
I think he stayed in bounds, too, which was a smart play by Ryan Grant. He knew he wasn't going to gain any yards, and he tried hard to stay in bounds, which he did, which keeps the clock moving. Senior out of Nyack, New York, played at Don Bosco Prep. I think Nyack, New York is the hometown of our sideline reporter, Tracy Wilson, if I'm not mistaken.
I don't think you are. Third and six. 7:41 to go. McKnight and Shelton are the wideouts, both to the left side. Here's Quinn. Here comes the blitz. There goes Quinn. It's knocked down.
It was dangerous.
Was it ever.
Tennessee is coming after Brady Quinn. That ball a little bit behind his tight end, Fasano. And nearly picked off.
Look at Kevin Burnett climb the ladder.
That's called selling out. That's doing whatever it takes to get back to the quarterback. Jason Allen, the two leaders of this defense, along with Jesse Mahalona. Jason Allen and Kevin Burnett teaming up on that one.
Fourth and six, 39-yard attempt, DJ Fitzpatrick. Shelton will hold. Kick cuts inside and is perfect. Right down the middle.
And again, a huge difference now. It's still a one-score game. But a field goal doesn't help Tennessee. They need a touchdown to overtake Notre Dame now.
...60 minutes, Sunday. Here's the kick. Corey Larkins gathers it in. Finds himself in trouble and is
nice
caught
coverage.
Short of the 18-yard line. Now let's check the CBS Sportsline stat of the game. This Tennessee team came in averaging 181 yards on the ground per game. And today, this is not really a shock, however, as well as Notre Dame defends the run. They've held Tennessee to 82 yards. Get complete game stats at CBSSportsline.com.
Just to follow up on those numbers for Notre Dame, the 12th best run defense in the country. They've held five teams under 100 yards rushing, including Michigan. And we know they're a powerful team. 30 carries for 56 yards in their win against Michigan back in September.
17-13, Tennessee first down. And Clawson will take it from the spread. Being chased from behind, fires it out. There's Tony Brown, the senior co-captain, wide open at the 27-yard line. In front of Preston Jackson.
Nice throw by Clawson. A lot of time for Tennessee. Again, they need a touchdown to take the lead. Look at his numbers, 6 of 11. Pretty good outing for a guy who didn't get many reps in practice this weekend. Both Philip Fulmer and Randy Sanders said, you know, he's a guy who we are comfortable with because he's a guy who doesn't need all the physical reps. He pays attention. He understands the game. He can manage it. He may not be able to just flat out throw it as well as Eric Ainge, but he'll know what he's doing.
Here's second down, handoff, and they avoid the first tackle. Houston.
Nice run.
Yes, it was.
Boy, that was started out like it was going to be stopped in the backfield because of penetration, and then at least stopped for no gain. And as it turned out, Cedric Houston turned it into a first down. Good penetration by Landry, and then Zibikowski not able to make the tackle, and Cedric Houston turns it into a first down.
And Tom Zibikowski in pain, bent over. Medical staff comes out to assist him. And while we have a chance, let's remind you of a doubleheader. The NFL on CBS tomorrow. In the first game, the Jets go into Buffalo, Oakland to Carolina, and Kansas City at Tampa Bay. And in the nightcap, New England at St. Louis and Houston at Denver. It all begins with the NFL today. Greg, Dan, Shannon, Boomer. tomorrow, 12 Eastern. Zbikowski out, first down and 10. And Freddie Parrish has taken his place wearing number 2.
Freddie Parrish actually was the starter at strong safety coming out of fall camp until they moved Zbikowski from free safety over 2 days before their opener against BYU. So he's a guy who is a capable player in there now.
Make the draw, four wide. Here's Clawson. Got a man open at the 50. Jason Swain out of bounds across the 50 at the 47-yard line. 21-yard gain.
Well, again, respecting the speed, look at this cushion that they're giving on the out route. I mean, that's a lot of cushion. You don't want to get beat deep. You don't want to give up the big play, try to keep everything in front, but that's an easy throw and catch for Rick Clawson and Jason Swain. Again, you don't want to play not to lose on both offense or defense.
First down and 10. They need a touchdown. 6:07 to go. Here's Clawson, five-step drop. Fires it up. Driving catch.
Oh, what a catch.
Yes, indeed. Faton, who's
now they're saying it hit the ground. Now they're saying it's incomplete.
And a quick call by both officials.
I thought he just lost the helmet and not the ball, but they're calling it off, saying it hit the ground. A nice effort by Faton. He went up in between two defenders. Does he have it? Can't see it from that angle. It was the official that was coming from this direction that made the call, the change.
Well, from that direction, it appeared he had it. Nope.
The ball hit the ground.
Nope.
And again, the official that called it a completion was blocked. The other guy coming in from the opposite side made the correction.
Good piece of officiating by the Big Ten crew at second down. Here's the little flip out in the side. Houston has to go one-on-one to the secondary, and he gets down to the 37-yard line. 5:50 to go in this one. Let's go back to the studio for a Pontiac game-changing performance. Here's Tim.
All right, Vernon, it could be another season-changing play. Chad Schroeder is the holder. Dennis Franchione pulling out all stops. 6 yards to Joey Thomas on the fake field goal on fourth down. We are tied at College Station.
Now, Tim, you don't suppose those folks who have a week off down in Auburn, Alabama are paying? I wonder if they're watching this game or that one.
It might be one of those picture-in-a-picture games, you know?
That's right. First down and 10. Here comes the blitz. They got him.
Yeah.
From the corner, Derek Curry.
They've not blitzed much. That one was a timely call by Kent Bear. They brought a linebacker, Derek Curry, off the edge, and nobody accounted for him. And I don't know if this was a bust by Tennessee or not, but here's Curry. He comes late and nobody picks him up. You see, there's a couple linemen in here not blocking anybody. That was a well-timed blitz by Notre Dame.
Coming up next, the TIAA Kreft College Football Today program, time permitting. Eric Ainge, Brent Schaefer look on. It's a second down and 15 at the 40.
Here they come again. Here they come again.
Got him again.
Back-to-back blitzes. This time it's Goolsby, who has had a huge game for the Irish. They have gone a long time without coming after either one of the Tennessee quarterbacks. Now on back-to-back plays, they bring pressure from that side and this side, and Goolsby comes to the backside. Remember, Boston, a left-handed quarterback, that's his blind side. He had no idea Goolsby was coming.
Third and 23, Chuck Prue in his first start, the six-year senior. Clawson has been sacked twice now, last two plays. And they're back in their own end of the field, just by a couple of inches. Three-man rush, screen pass. And they get Houston
by Justin Tuck reading that play. He said, you know what? You fooled me on a screen earlier. I'm not going to get fooled this time. Whenever a guy lets me rush this fast to the quarterback, something's up. And he read it quickly and fell back in and made the play.
And as a result, Dustin Colquitt comes on fourth and 23.
Eighth tackle of the ball game for Justin Tuck. He has really been an impact player for this Notre Dame defense.
Snap is back, Colquitt's kick. At the 18, breaks a tackle, gets to the 27. Notre Dame takes over. A 32-yard punt, 9 on the return. And let's recap Justin Tuck's day.
Well, he came in tied for the Notre Dame career lead in sacks. He got that in the first quarter. He added on another sack later in the ball game. And then six more tackles, including this last one on the screen play. One of the impact players on this Notre Dame defense has played hard and well tonight.
Irish want this one. If they win it, they are bowl eligible. Tennessee has two timeouts left. Here's the toss. Darius Walker comes right. And Notre Dame still doing a fine job of protecting the ball.
And I think that's the biggest thing. I think right now the only thing that can hurt Notre Dame is if they get careless with the football. There's 3 minutes and 10 seconds left in the ball game. They have not turned it over. They've managed the game. If they protect the football, they're probably going to slip out of here with a win.
Tennessee timeout, 3:10 to go. Through on Rick Clawson, and that's the margin of difference right now, 17-13.
Significant number for Notre Dame, that last run by Walker, who has 9 carries for 70 yards, gave Notre Dame 101 yards rushing in the ball game. Not a huge number, but it's been effective enough to keep this Tennessee defense at bay and keep the lead.
Second down. Here's Quinn, right side. And a tackle made from behind on Ryan Grant. That will set up a third down. 3:04 to go. And I believe the Volunteers have used their final timeout. They have indeed. Well, Philip Fulmer graduated from Tennessee. 13th year as the head coach. His team trails at home. Eric Ainge can do naught but watch. Remaining. This is a Tennessee team that has had a gaudy November record under Philip Fulmer. They've only lost 4 times, one of those times to this Notre Dame team in 1990 when the Irish were number one. They also lost here 2 years ago to a Miami team that was one then ranked number one. The other losses were both on the road at Arkansas, at Memphis. But that record in jeopardy now. They trail by 4, 3:04 to go. They are out of timeouts. It's 3rd and 4, Notre Dame.
3 of 13 on third down. Notre Dame, great win.
Gonna close it up. Yeah. Didn't get it. Now we'll see when the ball is marked for play and the clock will continue to unravel. Tackle made by Justin Harrell.
It hasn't been started yet. This is a play where Brady Quinn says, if a guy's wide open, I'll throw it. If not, don't take any chances. Run the football, protect it, run as much clock as we can, and then let's hope for a big-time punt from DJ Fitzpatrick. It's down to 2 minutes and 32 seconds now. The play clock's still at 21, so Notre Dame can wait for several more seconds before they snap on this punt.
This is the 10th punt of the ball game, and it's not a good one. Hefney, it bounces in front of him, goes out of bounds in the vicinity of the 27-yard line.
A decent bounce on the punt. I'm just surprised why they snapped it so soon. They could have maybe run off another 15 to 18 seconds.
Well, our player of the game in this one, the man who made the big play of the game, Mike Goolsby. His first career touchdown, his second career interception, 26 yards. That made it a 14-10 edge for Notre Dame. They now lead it 17-13. Rick Clawson and the Volunteers.
Our crack statistician Chuck Gardner corrected me. I think I said 15 seconds. There were 13 seconds on the play clock, so they could have run off at least 10 more. And all those seconds are precious for Rick Clawson with no timeouts for the Tennessee offense right now, needing a touchdown.
Fumble.
The second bad shotgun snap we've seen.
And it should be pointed out, that Chuck Prue is starting his first game today. Justin Respert, who is the normal starter. Here's Prue, the sixth-year senior. And it was his low snap in the last play of the first half that ultimately resulted in the separated shoulder for Eric Ainge. Here's Tony Brown with a catch, but the air has gone out of the balloon.
Boy, that first, in a two-minute drive, that first play is so critical to have something positive, and that was exactly the opposite of what you would want on your first down play.
Third and 19, 1:27 to go. Under center. Incomplete, it'll be fourth down. Fourth and 19. Out of timeouts. Well, in the SEC standings, this has no effect whatsoever because it's an out-of-conference game. Georgia lost to Tennessee. Now, here's Tennessee is off next week,
right,
having played eight in a row. Then they are at Vanderbilt, and then they've got Kentucky. Now, their respective records under this man against those two, they've won 21 in a row against Vanderbilt, 19 in a row against Kentucky.
Tyrone Willingham just called a timeout. He stepped out on the field to the field judge and called for the timeout, which he's allowed to do, and wants to talk over something with his defense on this fourth down and long play.
Time called with 1:22 to go.
Almost over, boss! Almost here!
1:22 to go in the ball game. Notre Dame trying to become bowl eligible. Win their sixth game of the year. Significant injury in the game, the last play of the first half.
Yeah, last play, Eric Ainge down on that right shoulder. Before that point, he was 11 for 18, 149 yards and a touchdown. And certainly he would have made a difference for Tennessee had he played. But Notre Dame outplayed Tennessee in this ballgame. They have earned this victory because they completely shut down the Tennessee run and would have made it difficult on Eric Ainge in the second half, whether he was healthy or not.
Here's Clawson, fourth and 19, incomplete. Jason Swain, this one's going to the bank.
When I was in South Bend this past week, I picked up an edition, the most recent edition of the Blue Gold magazine, and there was a very scathing article in the magazine that criticized this Notre Dame team. Kind of rare in a team publication, questioning whether this was really a fighting Irish team, insinuating that they had kind of given up and laid down in the Boston College game, wondering if they could ever be that kind of team again. This team fought today, and they earned this victory.
And they will go to 6-3. Their losses at Brigham Young and at home against Purdue, a 41-16 defeat, three big plays in that one. And then 2 weeks ago to Boston College, the biggest win this season against Michigan, game two. And this one, I would think.
Yeah, absolutely.
On the road before 107,000. Philip Fulmer's team is going to taste defeat for only the second time this year. The first time was to Auburn.
And for Tennessee, as you mentioned, this does nothing to affect what they're doing in the SEC, but it certainly affects what they were doing on the national picture. Still in line for bigger things from a national championship perspective as this season winds down. That is pretty much gone at this point. They could still get a BCS bowl bid if they go to the championship game in Atlanta and win that game.
Well, this is the eighth consecutive game they've had without a break. They're off next week. The last time this Tennessee team played eight in a row was 2001. The eighth game was against LSU with a chance to go to the BCS championship game. They lost that one to LSU then. They lose this one to Notre Dame 17-13. Philip Fulmer and the Volunteers will be a long, long night. The final 17-13. For Todd Blackledge and Tracy Wolfson, I'm Vern Lundquist. Let's go to Tim Brando.
All right, Vern, thank you and welcome.